Okay, it's a pleasure to have Professor Edward Witten with us today, a very distinguished physicist from the Institute for Advanced Study in Princeton.
Thank you.
In fact, he has a long connection with ICTP. He was the first Dirac Medallist in 1985 for his important work on anomalies at the time when Abdus-Salam was around, which he shared with a great Soviet physicist, Yakov Zeldovich.
Yes.
And then, of course, his list of his awards is very long. I will not go through that. But in 1990, he received also the Fields Medal. So he's a distinguished physicist as well as mathematician. And he's here at ICTP this week for the Huddle that we have started at ICTP on quantum entanglement, space-time, and black holes, which explores these fascinating new connections between quantum entanglement, space-time geometry, and black holes. So before going into the history, maybe let's start with the present and the future.
Okay.
I mean, the past decade or so, or even two decades, one could say, has revealed this amazing connection between theories without gravity and theories with gravity.
Yes.
Quantum mechanics, quantum field theory on one hand, and general relativity on the other hand. And this seems to be a very rich exploration, which is, I think it's fair to say that the full implications of it are far from clear.
That's
so yeah, maybe do you want to start with your thinking, what you're currently thinking about, what you think are the important points in this beautiful connection?
Well, 20, 30 years ago, people like Susskind and Hooft, trying to unravel problems about quantum black holes, had the idea of holography, that somehow the physics in the interior and the presence of gravity is described holographically by some kind of ordinary quantum system on the boundary. It sounded like a very wild idea, but a couple of years later, in 1997, Juan Maldacena, inspired by computations in string theory, actually made what was then interpreted as a very concrete proposal for a holographic duality between ordinary theory on the boundary and quantum gravity in the interior. So we've known since 1997 that in some sense, this kind of duality between ordinary physics on the boundary and physics with gravity inside is real, but understanding it has been another matter and has come in different waves. And as you said, I think we're far from really getting to the bottom of things.
So, I mean, we can go back perhaps to the first string, superstring revolution.
Yes.
So you have been leading many of these developments, or have been the leading light. And we know that quantum field theory, in some sense, has been reigning supreme, that whatever is the experimental observations are very well described by.
Yeah.
We don't really need any further modification to our theory just to explain the data. But evidently, this is not satisfactory for many theorists.
There's really a problem with gravity. And so quantum field theory works beautifully to describe all the phenomena we know about that don't involve gravity. But it turns out that if you try to do gravity in the framework of quantum field theory, you run into a lot of trouble, basically because Einstein's highly nonlinear mathematics doesn't work well with quantum theory. So this was a puzzle for a long time. Of course, it's a rather esoteric puzzle because it's not clear that how it can be put to the test experimentally, but conceptually we've got both quantum mechanics and gravity in the same world, so they have to work together somehow. And I don't think anyone really ever had any good ideas about it. But in the early 70s, people who actually were trying to solve a different problem stumbled in string theory upon a way to generalize ordinary quantum field theory in a way that makes gravity unavoidable rather than impossible.
Yeah.
That was string theory. And the main reason, in my opinion, for all the interest in string theory ever since has been precisely that the pre-string framework in which we so successfully describe the rest of physics is really not compatible with gravity, yeah, while string theory forces gravity upon us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that's Yeah, because sometimes we take your colloquium, I think tomorrow will be on this
On
topic,
this theme, that's
on
right.
this topic. That one somehow takes some of these early successes of string theory, especially for the practitioners in the field, for granted.
Yes.
We almost get kind of jaded by that success, but it's actually an
Younger
extraordinary fact.
colleagues, my title tomorrow is What Every Physicist Should Know About String Theory.
Yes.
And I know that younger colleagues tend to find it disheartening that under that title I lecture about things that are so old-fashioned.
Yes. But even though they are old-fashioned, I mean, by our standards,
Yes.
given the
Old-fashioned here means they go back to the 70s and 80s.
that's right, yeah. But it's we have not really fully understood all
That's
the
completely
consequences.
correct, yes. We do not, we're grappling with things that we stumbled upon bits and pieces of, and there's been this incredible trail ever since, but we definitely haven't gotten to the bottom of any of it. That was true a moment ago when we were talking about holography and gravity, but it's also true when we discuss about what's really going on when quantum fields are generalized into strings. There's a fundamental mystery about that, what it really means. A dream is that all these things are tied together, maybe. Okay. Hopefully we're missing some general lesson about the link between gravity and thermodynamics. Likewise, we're presumably missing some general lesson about what's going on, what really is string theory even. It would be a dream if all those general lessons would somehow fit together, but we'll have to see.
Yeah, I had the good fortune of learning string theory from you. I remember you had this
In the
wonderful.
course of time.
This was in the when you were writing the Green-Schwarz-Witten book.
Well, in the spring of 87, I told.
Yeah, spring of 87.
Yes.
I was a student there.
I didn't put two and two together, but yes, that was roughly when you were a student.
And I remember it was attended by the people in the greater Princeton area, which in the 50-kilometer radius. But and it looked amazing, but within 10 years, somehow, despite all the successes of string theory, it was completely turned topsy-turvy.
Well, the subject was completely transformed by new discoveries within a decade of them. At that time, if you'd asked me for what was the best formulation I could give of what's the unsolved problem about string theory, I would have thought it was to be found. See, Einstein, okay. String theory, at some sense, even at the classical level, is different from Einstein's theory, even before you quantize it. Einstein's classical theory, which was all he understood, he never did quantize it, was based on new ideas about the dynamics of space-time and the curvature of space-time. And string theory, in some sense, clearly generalizes those concepts in a way we don't understand very well. In 1987, I'm sure I would have said that the deep problem was to understand the generalization of the Einstein-Hilbert action and of Einstein's principle of general covariance.
String field theory. Sort
yeah,
of.
Well, string field theory is an attempt to answer that. Do not believe I would have been committed to string field theory as the only approach, but some kind of classical theory whose quantization gave strings, I would have thought was the goal. But within a decade, there were non-perturbative dualities discovered that kind of made it clear in different ways that there's much more going on than that.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so this was what is sometimes referred as the second superstring.
Yes, although if I were doing the counting, it would be the third. The first superstring revolution should have been the period when Veneziano, Virasoro and others, Amati, and others of that generation pioneered things. And then the first period I participated in should have been called the second one.
Yes, okay.
And the phenomenon in the mid-90s I would have called the third superstring revolution.
That's right. And holography was yet to come, so
well,
duality.
At the time it's, right. Well, right.
Or you would put
I'm not sure. I would give up after three. I wouldn't know how to put holography in the numbering.
Yeah, so also, I mean, going back to duality, that also is another extremely surprising, and it's not only limited to string theory, also in quantum field theory,
yes,
where people thought they had understood quantum field theory. Now, with the work of you and Seiberg, and we somehow
many other people,
think many other people, we think of quantum field theory in quite a different way.
Well, we're more, well, of course, in two dimensions, it was known that there were all kinds of crazy
That's
non-perturbative
right.
phenomena and dualities. And I'm sure some people suspected it was also true in four dimensions, but we couldn't demonstrate it. Part of what's surprising is that all that, or to some of us, it might be, to me, since I tend to be conservative, it was a bit surprising that all that was true in four dimensions. But it was even more surprising that you could understand it
Yes.
because of the way that supersymmetry simplifies the study of the dynamics.
Yeah, and perhaps it was even more surprising. I remember this, it's one of these events where I'm happy to say I was there. It was this 1995, I think.
Oh, the strings conference,
Conference.
the essay.
You see, it was really a kind of extraordinary. I remember the buzz, and it was incredible. Because it was, yeah, nobody thought that, okay, maybe four dimensional gauge theories, but all the way to
Well,
10 dimensional string theory.
it's a funny thing there because, to a large extent, in my presentation there, I was putting together things that other people had really been saying,
Yes, which
just
is.
made little improvements here and there in some cases.
No, it's very true that Sen and Townsend and Hurl and many other people have
Yes.
important.
Let's remember John Schwartz.
John
In
Schwartz.
fact, what got me started at the previous strings meeting, which was in Berkeley in 1993, John Schwartz was much more excited than I'd seen him in a number of years.
Yes.
And what he was so excited about was the work he was doing with Sam on non-perturbative dualities.
Yes.
That, I didn't at the time know what to do with it, but that got me to start thinking in that direction. And it actually was only a few months after that that Natty at Seiberg was working on dynamics of n equals one.
Yes.
And he co he he sort of recruited me to work with him on n equals two. I think the reason he thought I'd be interested was that I had earlier discovered that n equals two Yangel's theory is related to four manifold theory. And I think Natty thought, and I know Michael Atiyah thought, that understanding the dynamics might have implications for four manifold theory. And that certainly proved to be correct.
Correct, yes.
But I wasn't really thinking that way at the time. So I started working with Natty because his work on n equals one had been interesting. So
This
I
was
just thought
1994, 1994, end of
the discussion started in the fall of 93,
93.
but the papers emerged in the spring or summer of 94. So for a few months, there wasn't much progress, but we knew that there were these duality conjectures going back to Monheim and Olive and wondered if they were relevant. And then during those months, a very famous paper by Ashok Sen came out, which for me was completely a turning point. This was his paper on the two manifold update.
Yeah, it's a beautiful paper.
So I thought, see, even though what Sen and Schwartz had done and that Schwartz is so excited about was very pretty and very interesting, it was sort of similar in spirit, I thought, to things that it had done before. Conceptually, it did involve, it was very, very nice that it worked and it was striking. But Sen's calculation of the two monopole bound state.
The dion to find the SL to Z part.
Yes. Well, that was, I thought, a real conceptual advance in the methods. But also, it was, you see, if anyone had the vision to try to do that calculation, it might have been done a few years before.
Yeah.
So that taught me that we were probably missing other opportunities as well.
Yes.
So after that paper came out, we were, I think, more focused on the role of duality, the possible role of duality than we'd been previously. But we didn't have a clear picture of what duality was supposed to mean for n equals two. Eventually, we understood that it's really, well, at least for the simplest n equals two theory, it's a statement about the infrared, not about the fundamental microscopic description like in n equals four. Anyway, it focused us more in the right direction of thinking about long poles and dyons, which ultimately were the right ingredients to use.
Yeah, so, and then the string dualities somehow all gelled within 4 or 5 months. Because I remember, you may not remember this, but I remember I met you in Jerusalem. There was a New Year's party
Yes.
in 1994.
At
And
the
you,
beginning of 94?
end of
1994,
1994.
yes. Okay.
And you said, oh, there is not much time left in 1994 for new ideas. But it was already the seeds of this must have been there in your mind, because in I think in May we had this whole change of perspective, and then which already other people like Helen Thompson were thinking about.
Well, I'd spent part of, well, after the work with Cyborg, it then was clear that all this was relevant to four manifolds. So I spent part of the fall of 94 trying to work on that. But my plan for what I wanted to do was too grandiose. Eventually, a few years later, with Greg Moore's help, we did what I originally wanted to do, that involved integration over the U-plane.
U-plane, okay. And also it's related to Mach Modell.
And eventually what you and I
did
just a year or two ago. But at some point, luckily, in the fall of 94, I decided that was too complicated and I had to do easier things. But then the mathematicians told me anyway, I should write up what I knew, even if I couldn't do it the way I wanted.
No, but you also wrote this very interesting paper with Cameron, which was also in a way had the glimpses of type 2 heterotopy. I mean, in hindsight, the type 2 heterotopy duality and the D4 bridge.
Yeah, well, Cameron and I, we were counting instantons, roughly speaking.
But you had the right
Cameron
speculation there. I mean,
sort of, yeah. Well, anyway, we discovered very strange facts, and Cameron told me, well, we're going to understand these facts. I said, well, no, it's impossibly far away. But Kerman was right, because within a year or two,
within a year, it was more or less understood.
Yes. But anyway, anyway, after the Cyborg-Witten papers, I spent a few months trying to do what was too hard on four manifolds, then had the sense to just write up a simple version and put the rest aside. Then I spent a few months, it bothered me that there were five string theories when only one was needed. So I thought maybe some of them are inconsistent. And I spent a few months at the beginning of 1995 trying to prove some of the string theories are inconsistent.
Some global anomalies.
Well, I wanted global anomalies, but I couldn't find any. I remember I had two arguments. One, I can't remember at all now what it was. But the other, I thought that if you imagine the strong coupling behavior of type 2A, you'd find a contradiction. Because
how long?
it looked like the BPS spectrum wasn't physically sensible, but at a certain point I realized that the BPS spectrum actually was
physically sensible.
Yes. So after that I stopped thinking that these string theories were inconsistent, which kind of was a silly thing to even try for, because it was at the time almost known that they were dual to each other. That wasn't completely known. But there were, like, the two heterotic strings were dual, the type two strings were dual. Daly and Palchinsky had a story relating type one to type two. I guess there was the heterotic world and the type one, type two world. Those hadn't yet been linked. Okay. You could have conceivably shown that one of the two worlds was inconsistent, but you couldn't have hoped to get it down to one string theory. But anyway, as you know, within a relatively short time, it became clear that no one was going to get rid of any of the string things. They were all different limits of each other.
That's right. Yeah, so that brings me to, I mean, I just want to ask you this more, it's a bit philosophical question, but
yes.
I think it's an important question, because I think there seems to be some misunderstanding about, I mean, oftentimes, I mean, it's evident that these are some very deep concepts, irrespective of how they will fit into a description of nature. Mm-hmm. I mean, it's not immediately clear.
Mm-hmm.
And oftentimes in physics, I mean, even with, I mean, this is a much more grand structure, but even with ideas like, let's say, Higgs mechanism, it took 50 years
to
find experimentally. Yeah. So clearly, I mean, sometimes in popular imagination, I think somebody used this word, paparazzis, you know, going back to Popper's principle of falsifiability applied in a rather naive way. That's okay, if you can falsify it. But oftentimes physics is, actual practitioners of physics are pursuing ideas with a long-term view, with not immediate falsifiability. But there is nevertheless a kind of an internal criteria of what constitutes important breakthroughs. I mean, there is no question in the minds of those who work in this field, that big advances being made. Yeah, do you have?
Well, one thing that's worth mentioning, though, is that apart from the dream of understanding physics at a deeper level involving gravity, work in string theory has been useful in shedding light on more conventional problems in quantum field theory and even in condensed matter physics, and as well with applications to mathematics. Apart from its intrinsic interest, those successes are one of the things that tend to give us confidence that we're on the right track.
Yes, yeah.
Because, speaking personally, I find it implausible that a completely wrong new physics theory would give rise to useful insights about so many different areas.
Yeah. Actually, I heard a very distinguished experimental physicist said this, that his approach to discovering new physics is to really improve the tools. I mean, it's not an attitude that you might expect to hear, because this is that if you have new tools,
yes,
then new discoveries follow. It's not always that you go looking for a specific physical phenomenon.
Yes.
And that, I think, is also true in theoretical explorations. And there seems to be a really clearly well understood internal criteria for what constitutes important advance and what is just not such an important advance. So it's probably a difficult question to answer, but okay, what do you... You have been... I mean, string theory community has been clearly pursuing something quite deep and important. And it may very well be that experimental realization could be many years or decades. And
unfortunately, that's quite possible. We have to hope for good fortune. It depends. There are things we can't control, how the nature of the answer, but how things work out in the real world.
Yes.
And the experiments we're able to do.
Mm-hmm. So let me ask you a bit about your connection with ICTP. I mean, you came here, I think Salam was instituted this prize in the Dirac Medal, and I think he was very proud to have chosen you, presumably. And
you. Oh, I was actually a rather regular visitor at the ICTP for quite a number of years, starting around 1977. My wife is from southern Italy. We used to come to Italy often in the summers and very frequently spend some time here at the ICTP.
Mm-hmm.
I must say that those were very exciting years to visit the ICTP, partly because of the environment that Salam created.
Yes, and I'm very happy that you're here now for this week.
Thank you.
So I know that you come from a academic family.
Yes.
Your father was also a physicist, and
yes,
your wife is also a theoretical physicist at Princeton.
Yes.
Do you want to share something about what brought you to physics? Because I know that you didn't. You probably wanted to resist what your father was doing.
I zigzagged a little bit, but then I discovered that my fate was physics. As you may know, my father, as you said, is a physicist whose work has largely been in general relativity.
But then you did, you were in journalism or something?
I zigzagged a little bit.
Yeah. Okay, now, Salam created this organization, but I mean, which is also something that is dear to my heart, is that apart from pursuing excellence and the frontiers of science, which is, for example, the Institute for Advanced Study is also a place like that. One of the impulses behind ICTP is to make knowledge globally available.
Yes.
Overcoming the barriers of geography.
Yes.
Class and gender.
The ICTP has done a great job in fostering physics in countries that have needed help in getting started.
Yeah. So even in a country like India, which, and as you know, string theory community in India is now very strong, but I remember ICTP played a very important role.
If you go back to the 70s and 80s, I think that the ICTP deserves a lot of credit for how physics has advanced in India.
Exactly. So, and the third aspect is sort of promoting international cooperation through science.
Yes.
And you have been perhaps a keen observer, I think, of this, the Sesame project that you know in Jordan. I think ICTP played many junctures. I mean, there were, of course, many contributors to this very important
yes.
initiative. But ICTP, if I'm not wrong, held a important conference in The Hague,
Yes.
bringing together scientists from different countries who might not have been on politically
Yes.
friendly terms, but somehow this power of science as a common platform and a common language to bring them together. And it looked like a kind of a pipe dream, in fact, at that time. I mean, to have something in Jordan supported by Iran and Israel, and
yes, it seemed like science fiction. And frankly, when everyone hears what's happening at Sesame, it sounds like news from an alternate universe.
That's right. Especially
news from an alternate universe where there's peace in the Middle East, but the countries are cooperating.
Yes, I think, so that's one I wanted to ask you about, that because, of course, difficult political, I mean, it's naive to expect that difficult political problems will get resolved through science diplomacy.
Yes.
But nevertheless, I think science can play at least a facilitator role.
At least give the different countries an example of an alternative possibility.
Yeah, to live together peacefully. Okay. So now I want to ask you a bit about your other half of your distinguished career having to do with mathematics. So, I mean, you have made many very deep contributions to mathematics. If I may read from the citations of your Fields Medal, time and again he has surprised the mathematical community by a brilliant application of physical insight, leading to new and deep mathematical theorems. And this, you know, this famous quote of Eugene Wigner, that about the unreasonable effectiveness of mathematics in physics.
Yeah.
But I want to ask you about this the other way around, the unreasonable effectiveness of physics in mathematics. Evidently, going back to Newton with calculus.
Yes, certainly. I was about to say that. Calculus is very central. Mathematics became far more powerful after calculus was developed. And it was developed because it was needed for physics.
But then with Dirac, with quantum mechanics, it spurred a lot of... But I think you have brought in, and I think you can be singularly credited for this, really quantum field theory as a tool for addressing, you know, various methods in quantum field theory.
I think the essential fact is that first of all, quantum field theory is difficult to understand mathematically because it's a little bit of a mystery why this is, but it's difficult to make it rigorous. So it's clearly an important tool in physics, and it has a lot of mathematical secrets, but mathematicians have had difficulty understanding it, so they have trouble learning the mathematical lessons that can be deduced from quantum field theory. So physicists, because they work with quantum field theory all the time, either in particle physics or as well in condensed matter, have these potential tools at our disposal, which turn out to be mathematically powerful. But I think that's half of it. The other half of it is that string theory has, well, first of all, is also very difficult for mathematicians to appreciate because the prerequisite, basically, is to understand quantum field theory as a physicist, and then you can understand what physicists are trying to do with string theory and proceed from there. But string theory seems to know a lot of mathematical secrets.
Yes.
And at the present stage of knowledge, physicists can work with that. Even though we don't understand string theory very well, we can still work with it more effectively than the mathematicians can. So there are opportunities there to extract some of these mathematical consequences.
But you did try, I think, I mean, there was, you had this set of lectures, I remember, Deline at the Institute for Advanced Study. How much do you think you succeeded in making?
Well, there was certainly, we had a special program and then the lecture notes were published about 1996 and 7, roughly, trying to explain quantum fields and strings to mathematicians. I think there was only a moderate success. There was some success, but I've come to believe that it's actually really important to have some sense of how quantum field theory works in the real world. If you try to understand quantum field theory just as a mathematical subject, without developing the intuition you get from its applications in the real world, it proves to be difficult.
It proves to be difficult. I guess, I mean, there's this clear problem of, I mean, maybe understanding QCD would be...
Proving the mass gap of actually pure gauge theory rather than
QCD. Pure gauge theory, that's what I meant, yes. That would be a step towards the rigor, I think.
Well, if that problem were solved, that would be... It would mean that... it's a little hard to speculate what would come after because it would depend on how difficult and technical the solution was. But potentially, quantum field theory would be more accessible mathematically if that kind of thing were understood. But the Clay problem, as defined, is extremely difficult because it asks not just for an existence proof, but for a proof of the mass gap, which I actually worry makes it too hard.
Yeah, even the existence.
I feel that the existence could be proved without proving the existence of a mass gap. The existence is basically a question about the ultraviolet
limit.
You need some control of the infrared.
I see. Uh-huh.
But you see, you might be able to prove that the theory exists
in the UV
with parallel decay of correlations in the IR, without being able to prove that they have exponential decay. Think of the two-dimensional nonlinear sigma model, say of a two-sphere, which was suggested by Polyakov a long time ago as a practice problem. There's a theta angle. For generic values of the theta angle, it's massive in the infrared, but at theta equals pi, it's actually believed to be massless in the infrared. So
it's not necessary for the existence of the UV theory.
Right.
That's what you want to say.
Yes. And you can well imagine, in this case, because there's one over n expansion, in this case, you might be able to use the one over n expansion to prove results that would be true for sufficiently large n. But in a case where you didn't have a one over n expansion, you could well imagine being able to prove existence and not be able being able to decide the question of a mass gap.
Yes, okay. Maybe they should have $2 million. But you mentioned Michael Atiyah. I mean, your work on supersymmetry anomalies had these beautiful connections with index theory.
Yes.
And then you've done all this, all the work on Seibert-Witten theory, knot theory, Donaldson theory. I mean, the amount, number of applications are also geometric Lang lens program. It's quite astonishing how much power quantum field theory has given to make some progress in difficult mathematical problems. But Atiyah was an important influence on your in your career and your thinking. So you want to say something about his your experience with or what?
One thing I'd like to say is that he's the one who told me about Montan and Olive duality. So,
even though it's a physics paper.
Yes, I think he had probably been talking to Peter Goddard or Olive as well.
Olive, probably.
Well, before, we have to remember that before Montan and Olive, there was Goddard, Moitz, and Olive.
Yes.
And, I don't really know. I'm almost certain that, that he had been talking to Goddard as well. What really happened was that at least from my point of view, what happened was that the Engmills instanton and the work of Atoft solving the U1 problem using instantons, first of all, got physicists excited about differential geometry. We hadn't modern questions in topology and differential geometry we hadn't been familiar with. And then I first heard the names Atiyah and Singer from a paper by Albert Schwartz. Albert Schwartz was the one, Atoft had solved the U1 problem using a fermion zero mode in instanton field, similar to work of Jakiev and Rebbe involving monopoles. But Atoft solved the Dirac equation in an instanton field and found a zero mode. Then Albert Schwartz explained that the zero mode was a consequence of the Atiyah-Singer index theorem.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And certainly, I was shown that paper by Sidney Coleman, and it was one of several important papers Sidney showed me. This one, I think, would have...
And you were a postdoc at Harvard at the time. Right. Yeah.
This paper, I think, I would have learned about anyway. But some of the important papers Sidney showed me never became well known, and I think I would not have known about them otherwise. An important example in view of my later work on the drones polynomial was Albert Schwartz's paper on analytic torsion and what nowadays is called BF theory. He didn't know to call it BF theory. He called it a degenerate quadratic functional. In hindsight, that's more or less had to do with the abelian limit of Transimons theory. So later on, okay, Sydney showed me that paper when it came out in about 77 or 78, and I didn't think about it again until a decade later when I remembered it, when it was handy. Anyway, going back, the instanton and its connection to the index theorem, and no doubt other things that maybe Atiyah and Singer would have told you about, but were less obvious from my point of view, caused physicists and mathematicians to start talking more around 1976 and 7.
Yes.
And Atiyah visited at Harvard, where I was a postdoc, and as a result of our discussions there, he invited me to visit him in Oxford at the end of 77. And I went, and for a few weeks we talked a lot about the H theories, and by this time they had discovered the ADHM construction of instantons.
Yeah.
You have to imagine that at that time, I was a little younger than either of us is right now.
We were all young then.
With a little bit impatience. And Atiyah probably had the disconcerting experience of discovering that whatever they did, a physicist would tell them that they should do something else that would help even more with the quantum theory. Anyway, we talked a lot for a few weeks. And then...
Well, what did you tell him to do?
Well, something that would help with quantum angles there.
I see.
But in hindsight, an instanton gas only has limited use for the quantum theory. But roughly 20 years later, we learned that the ADHM construction and the instanton gas are useful for supersymmetric versions of the theory.
Right.
But it was would have been a stretch to think of that in 1977. Anyway, though, toward the end of my stay in Oxford,
you went to visit him in Oxford.
Yes, yes. For about a month. Toward the end of my stay in Oxford, he showed me that these two papers, I think, of Gaudinot and Olive and Montana and Olive, and suggested I go to London to talk to Olive about the Montana and Olive paper.
Wow.
I couldn't, well, so I did. Nice. I realized possibly part of what was going on is that after talking to me for so much for a few weeks, he wanted to find something else for me to do for a day or two. But anyway, I went to London and talked
enjoy
to
London. Yes, okay.
Yeah, talked to, I think I'd not been in London before. So, and I didn't get to see much because all I did on that visit was talk to David Olive. By the time I arrived, I was skeptical because the Montana and Olive story was expressed in terms of a purely bosonic Yang-Mills theory coupled to a scalar. There were a lot of problems with it.
Mm-hmm.
For starters, they needed the Higgs potential to vanish, and that isn't really a well-defined concept quantum mechanically.
Mm-hmm.
And you can go in for there and raise all kinds of technical objections. So I was a skeptic. But as we were talking, we realized that a supersymmetric version of the conjecture would make more sense. And by the end of the day, we realized that maybe the facts they were talking about could be justified better in n equals 2 or n equals 4 super Yang-Mills theory, which led to the paper we wrote.
Yeah. I think that was a very key insight, because discovering the central charges in supersymmetric algebras, because this whole work on BPS states and to get any control over the strong coupling would not have been possible.
Well, it's true that it was important later, but it's also true at that time I drew the wrong conclusion.
Which was?
Well, you see, as I told you in those days, I was very impatient, but I also was very conservative in my attitudes. So I was very reluctant to adopt what seemed like an extreme hypothesis if the facts had a more conservative explanation. And I felt we'd been able to explain the facts that Montana and Olive had pointed out without assuming a non-perturbative duality. We'd been able to explain those facts just from supersymmetry. And that caused me to remain skeptical about Montana and Olive duality. In fact, I remained skeptical
until probably 10th.
To what we said before, well, the interaction with Schwartz in 93 and then Sen's paper 6 months later, or whatever, exactly whenever it was. After Sen's paper, I gave up on being skeptical. We simplified the story before because there were a few other clues that were important in wearing down my skepticism before Sen's work, including your paper with Jeff Harvey.
Yes, okay. Okay, but okay.
And a few others.
But
anyway, it was partly because of my skepticism that Olive and I had showed that n equals 2 or n equals 4 were more reasonable arenas for Montan and Olive duality. But if you took Montan, but then there was, okay, which of them? I think, I'm having trouble remembering now, but I think it was Osborne.
Yes, Osborne put it to n equal to 4.
Yeah, Osborne showed that if you worry about the monopole spin, you find it should be n equals 4 because
you get
the monopoles.
Multiplet, yes.
The monopoles for n equals 2 are in hypermultiplets, but for n equals 4, they're in vector multiplets. So if you were taking the Montan and Olive conjecture seriously, which I wasn't at this time because I thought we'd found a conservative explanation of the facts, then you would have possibly been inspired to do what Osborne did.
Yes, yes.
Which was certainly an important thing to do in hindsight.
Yes, yes. Mm-hmm.
So I didn't really go back to it seriously until 1993, when some of these other things were happening that had worn down my skepticism. The experience with non-perturbative dualities in string theory, on the Wilcher, two-dimensional ones, had been part of it.
Mirror symmetry.
Mirror symmetry, yeah. For example, and even abelian Tiedemann. But also, another paper that had an impact on me was by Callan, Harvey, and Strominger.
Yes.
On small instantons.
Oh.
As hadronic five bins. Well, I was puzzled about the meaning of the phenomenon they were finding at the core of the small instanton.
Yes.
And later development showed
that's
a good thing.
Yeah, it was right.
But at the time, we couldn't.
But I wanted to ask you, I mean, for example, your work on index theory, I mean, Witten index, and
yes.
It's a kind of a beautiful generalization of index theory, which Atiyah played a role. Did, or was that a separate path that did discussions with Atiyah inspire you to think in that direction, or this was something else?
Well, Atiyah helped me understand what the index meant and why it was a topological invariant. But if you understand the concept of the index, you can generalize it to a supersymmetric theory.
Right, right. So that was something
that was a little bit different. Where I was more directly influenced by T and Bott, though, was in Moore's theory.
Yes.
Uh-huh. So at this Cargez summer school, I forget which year it was, maybe 1979, for some reason, T and Bott had taken it upon themselves to educate us about Moore's theory. I had most definitely never heard of Moore's theory, even of the name Moore's. My guess is that none of the physicists in the audience had heard of Moore's theory before, but I can't say for sure. Anyway, they gave us a couple lectures on Moore's theory, and it was very cute.
Interesting.
But I didn't have anything to do with it. But later I was trying to understand why it was so difficult to spontaneously break supersymmetry.
Mm.
And since it was difficult, I kept looking at simpler and simpler models. And finally I got to what seemed like the simplest model of all, which was in quantum mechanics, in other words, 0 + 1 dimensions, with scalar superfields and a superpotential. It was still hard to break supersymmetry. And finally, I realized, well, at a certain point, I think I was in a swimming pool in Aspen, Colorado. I remembered Bott's lecture about what he called baby Morse theory, and realized that the superpotential could be interpreted as a Morse function.
Mm-hmm.
So that was directly influenced in more detail, I would say, by Etienne Bott. Just defining the index of a supersymmetric quantum field theory, I'd say, is not that hard if you've been exposed to the index in quantum mechanics.
Yeah, once, yeah. And I remember reading this paper of yours in India as an undergrad, which really inspired me to wanting to go to Princeton about supersymmetry breaking in 1983 or 82.
Constraints on supersymmetry.
Constraints on supersymmetry. Okay, so one last question I want to ask you. Going back to Eugene Wigner's original quote, I mean, it is true that to some extent, the unreasonable effectiveness of mathematics could be explained by maybe the way our brain works. I mean, we somehow are able to abstract a triangle from a wiggly triangle and make some generalization and discover Euclidean geometry. But in some cases, the connection is so distant, like complex numbers playing a role in quantum mechanics, something which is completely invented by human beings, being so important in the description of the real world.
Yeah.
I don't know if, I mean, it's, you probably have nothing more to say.
I have nothing to say except a slightly tongue-in-cheek remark that it's as if the universe had been created by a mathematician.
Mathematician. Okay, so it was a pleasure, Edward.
Oh, thank you.
Talking to you.